ठीक है,
मैं चेक करता हूँ।
सो गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीबडी। टुडेज लेक्चर इज ऑन रिकेट्सियल इन्फेक्शंस। दिस लेक्चर इज स्पेशली इम्पॉर्टेंट फॉर योर एमसीक्यू पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू, फॉर योर एग्जाम्स। एग्जाम्स में यू विल गेट, एज फार एज योर एमबीबीएस एग्जाम्स इज कंसर्न, यू विल बी गेटिंग नॉट मोर देन वन क्वेश्चन प्रॉबेबली, दैट टू मेनी अ टाइम्स इट इज नॉट, नहीं होता है, बट इट इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फॉर योर एमसीक्यूज। बाय एंड लार्ज इसमें से क्वेश्चन आएगा ही आएगा, इट इज समथिंग लाइक दैट। ओके, सो आई एम डॉक्टर प्रियम, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन माइक्रोबायोलॉजी। सो लेट्स गेट गोइंग। सो वाई इज इट इम्पॉर्टेंट? दे आर रिकेट्सियल इन्फेक्शंस वर रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर अ ह्यूज नंबर ऑफ आउटब्रेक्स, स्पेशली द वर्ल्ड वॉर्स एंड द इट इज इम्पॉर्टेंट टू नो दैट द नेपोलियंस आर्मी was more than half of it was killed by rickettsial infections only. It was in 1810 that it was properly described, after it had killed millions in the world wars. In 1909, Charles Nichols, whose photograph is this, it is important to know that you get image-based questions also for your MCQs. So that is why I put this thing, because he was a Nobel Prize winner. In 1909, he got the Nobel Prize. He got the Nobel Prize because he described the role of lice in the causation of these rickettsial infections, which was the major cause of the epidemics at the time of your world wars. The culture was difficult, but it was eventually cultured by Ricketts and Provozac, who ultimately died because of this disease only. And in 1916, the Weil-Felix test, the very famous, which will come later on, was described. Now coming on to the taxonomy, they belong to the domain bacteria, the phylum Proteobacteria, class alpha Proteobacteria. Order is Rickettsiales. In the order Rickettsiales, there are two families. One is the Rickettsiaceae and the other one is the Anaplasmataceae. When we come to Rickettsiaceae, Rickettsiaceae has two pathogenic genera, the Rickettsia and the Orientia. We will be studying primarily this. The Orientia is a cause of scrub typhus, which is important pathogen. Rickettsia are classified into two groups, typhus group and the spotted fever group. Anaplasmataceae has four obligatory intracellular organisms named as Ehrlichia, Wolbachia, Anaplasma and Neorickettsia. The class will be concentrating more on the Rickettsiaceae. Last 2-3 slides I have kept for Anaplasmataceae because it comes for your MCQs. Just to give you an acquaintance, what is it exactly? Now, it was discovered by Howard Taylor Ricketts in 1911. Who isolated Rickettsia rickettsii. They are small, non-motile, gram-negative coccobacilli, which contain both DNA and RNA. The important thing is that they are obligate intracellular pathogens. That is, why are they obligate intracellular? Because they are dependent on the hosts for enzymes for glycolysis, the PPP pathway, purine, pyrimidine and amino acid synthesis pathways. Since they are obligate intracellular, they were originally confused with your viruses. But it is important to know that they are gram stained, they can be seen under the light microscope, they have both DNA and RNA. So these are few differences which help them in differentiating from the viruses. I am telling you all this because especially for my residents, because they are also logged in, because few of the teachers, they are in the habit of asking, ma'am, what is the difference between viruses and the rickettsia. So these are the few important differences between viruses and rickettsia. They are well stained by Jimza, Jimenez, acridine orange and other stains. They are not cultivated in the artificial media. They grow in cell lines or by animal egg inoculation. They are transmitted by arthropod vectors such as flea, tick, mite and louse, and they are susceptible to antibiotics. So if we go, why are they similar to your viruses is because they are obligate intracellular, and to grow they have to be grown under cell lines, your by egg or animal inoculation. But how are they different from the viruses? Because they are gram stained, they can be easily seen under the light microscope. DNA, they have both DNA as well as RNA, and they are susceptible to your antibiotics. So these are the differences from your viruses. Okay, now the family Rickettsiaceae mein, we are going to first study the genus Rickettsia. Their antigenic structure, it consists of a cell wall which has peptidoglycan, lipopolysaccharide, outer membrane, which has outer membrane proteins. These are all similar to your gram-negative cell wall. They have group-specific alkali stable lipopolysaccharides in some of the Rickettsia. The important thing is that it is because of this alkali stable lipopolysaccharide that this alkali stable lipopolysaccharide is shared by some Proteus species also, like the OX19, OXK and OX2 strains. This is important when we come to the Weil-Felix reaction. These are the group specific alkali stable, and then we have the species specific outer membrane proteins which help them in differentiating from in the spotted fever group and the typhus group. The spotted fever group has OMPA, whereas the OMPB is present both in the spotted fever as well as the typhus fever group. Now how do they cause the disease? That is the pathogenesis. They are generally transmitted by an arthropod vector, by ticks or mite bite. In the ticks and mite, they are transovarially transmitted also, and these ticks and mites act as the reservoirs. In case of louse and flea, it is generally by auto-inoculation or by aerosols. That is, these lice or flea, they will lay their feces on the skin. And if you do rubbing and scrubbing of the abraded skin or mucosa, either by, or this is the method of auto-inoculation, or by inhalation of that dried feces, that is by aerosol. So now how does it go about? Once it enters into the body, it spreads via the lymphatics to the lymph nodes, then to the bloodstream. Its major target cells are basically your vascular endothelial cells. In case of few like Rickettsia acari and Rickettsia suchugemusi, Oriensia suchugemusi, it is the monocytes. They attach to the by the outer membrane proteins A and B, and they are ingested into the target cells. Then they multiply by the binary fission. It is important that basically, when they reach the vascular endothelial cells, they are going to cause vasculitis, and because of that vasculitis and inflammation, there is going to be thrombosis, which produces the manifestations either on the skin or when it gets disseminated inside the organs, it causes the same manifestations. The manifestations are because of the vasculitis oblique thrombosis which they cause. This is one MCQ, if I may say. They enter inside the cell, the typhus group stays inside the cytoplasm, and the spotted fever group stays in the nucleus. This is one MCQ which normally comes. This is another MCQ. Matlab, I'm just trying to highlight that this particular chapter, more than anything else, it's important for your MCQs subsequently. Their growth is enhanced by sulfonamides and it is inhibited by tetracyclines and chloramphenicol. Why is this important? Because as you all know, in your PHCs and all, rickettsial infection normally presents with fever with rash. The most common antibiotic which is given in your primary health setups is your sulfonamides, your cotrimoxazole. So once you give cotrimoxazole in a patient who has one any of the rickettsial infection, the patient will go into fulminant fever because the growth of the rickettsia is enhanced by sulfonamides. So the only antibiotics which is used for the treatment is tetracyclines, that is your doxy. And if the patient is allergic to doxy or something, then you give chloramphenicol. So they multiply, as I've already told this thing, they multiply in the endothelial cells of the small blood vessels, causing vasculitis with lymphocytic predominance, swelling, necrosis, and vascular thrombosis. If it is in the skin, it produces your rash. And if it is in the brain, it causes your characteristic typhus nodules in the gray matter, another MCQ. And vasculitis and because of the vasculitis and inflammation in the other organs, it leads to DIC and infarcts. So this is a table which is given in all possible books, whichever you read. So we know that rickettsia is divided into two groups primarily, and that is your typhus group and the spotted fever group. And Oriensia causes the belongs to the scrub typhus group. Now this is the table which you will see in most of your books, so I'll go step wise. In this table, important is which disease is transmitted by lice, which is transmitted by flea, which is transmitted by mite, and which is transmitted by tick. These are also questions. Then these are also MCQs basically. Now coming on to the typhus group. Typhus group has two main species, that is your Rickettsia probazaki and Rickettsia typhi. Rickettsia probazaki causes epidemic typhus or Brill's insert disease transmitted by lice, predominantly by rash and fever. Now let's go step wise. Okay, epidemic typhus is caused by infection with Rickettsia probazaki, which is also known as the classical typhus or the louse-borne typhus or gaol fever. They are present in all, it is present in all the continents except Australia. It is endemic in your Central and South America, Africa, and certain parts of Asia. It has caused the largest outbreak, that is your Burundi outbreak in 1997. In India, the first case was reported in 1808 in Uti, and it has caused outbreaks in the Himalayan hills to Kullu valleys. Okay, so all these are your MCQ questions. The vector for this is the human body louse or the Pediculus humanus corporis or head louse, but not the pubic louse. It is, as we know, lice and flea ke case mein, the mode of transmission is either by aerosols or by auto-inoculation. So the main risk factors for all these louse or flea borne is your unhygienic overcrowded conditions like your camps, prisons, and overcrowded communities. So next we come to the clinical features. They have an incubation period of 1 to 2 weeks, acute febrile illness which is accompanied by headache, myalgia, eye discharge, and rashes. So important here is your fever and your rashes. Rashes ka distribution is important, that it begins on the upper trunk, usually on the fifth day, and it involves the entire body except your face, palms, and soles. So this is important exclusion, that it will not involve your face, palm, and sole. Myalgia is severe and it can lead to end organ damage, leading to various complications like interstitial pneumonitis, CNS involvement leads to mental confusion, coma, myocarditis, and acute renal failure. So these are your features of epidemic typhus. Epidemic typhus, Rickettsia probazaki also needs to your Brill-Zinser disease. Brill-Zinser disease is basically a recrudescence disease. That is, the patient gets recovered, but the pathogen persists in the lymph nodes, and once, years later, when there is waning of immunity because of some immunocompromised state, then it again leads to similar manifestations like your earlier first episode, that is a fever with rash, etc. So in this case, the host, the human in itself, acts as a reservoir for your this thing, pathogen. So this may be this cause of initiation of epidemics. Next we come to endemic typhus or the murine typhus or flea borne typhus. The vector is your rat flea, Xenopsylla cheopsis, or rarely it can be the cat flea, that is Clinocephalidis felis. The mode of transmission for flea is also same, autoinoculation or ingestion. Reservoir here is rat, rodents, that is Rattus rattus or Rattus norvegicus. Geographical distribution, it is endemic throughout the world except in, especially in the tropics, which have a high rice rat infestation. The clinical features are similar to your epidemic typhus, that is same, fever, headache, rash, myalgia, anorexia. Rash in this case involves the trunks only. So this is how you differentiate. Isme differentiate karna aise hi padega with the help of rash kahan kahan pe hai. If it is endemic, it is involving your trunk. If it is epidemic, it is involving the whole of the body except your palms and soles. Next we come to your spotted fever group. Spotted fever group has Rickettsia rickettsii, Rickettsia conori, acari and Africae. Primarily it is either tick borne or mite borne. Acari is mite borne, the rest of the three are your tick borne. So epidemic typhus and endemic typhus are louse or flea borne, and your spotted fever group is tick or mite borne. Now most important of this is your Rocky Mountain spotted fever, which is caused by Rickettsia rickettsii. It is caused by various tick genera. In different areas it is different, like Dermacentor andersoni in USA, Emblyoma in Central South America, Rippicephalus in Mexico, Arizona, Brazil, etc. The mode of transmission for ticks and mites is by bite. Reservoir is either the ticks or the other mammals like dogs or rats, which maintain the pathogen in it. Geographical distribution, it has areas in where there is high tick population in USA, Central and South America. Majorly it occurs in the tick season, that is your summers, and it is more common in your children and male, that is basically the outdoor population. Now coming on to clinical features of Rocky Mountain spotted fever. It has an incubation period of 4 to 14 days. Again the same, fever, headache, myalgia, rash, anorexia. Here it is the rash which is characteristic. We have studied in epidemic typhus and endemic is only the trunk. Epidemic is all over the body except palms and soles. In Rocky Mountain spotted fever, it is the whole body with the trunk as well as the extremities, and the most important is that they are hemorrhagic. Initially they will begin as maculopapular rash, and the characteristic thing that which comes in your MCQs is that they are hemorrhagic later on. So it leads to lot of complications because of vascular damage, your DIC, hemorrhage, increased permeability, edema, interstitial pneumonitis, CNS involvement, myocarditis, renal failure. So this is another important one. The other tick-borne fevers, Indian tick typhus, India mein we have Rickettsia conori, caused by Rippicephalus sanguineus bite. Clinical features are again the same. But the thing is that it might have eschar in 50% of the cases. Rocky Mountain spotted fever did not have an eschar. In this, there can be an eschar. This is important when you differentiate it from scrub typhus. We'll be coming to it later. This Indian tick typhus is present in Nagpur, Jabalpur, Sagar, Pune, Lucknow, Bangalore and Secunderabad. Also known as the Mediterranean spotted fever, Kenya tick typhus, Israeli spotted fever, or Astrakhan spotted fever. Then we have the African, just to complete the list, African tick typhus caused by Rickettsia africae, endemic in sub-Saharan Africa. Maculatum disease caused by Rickettsia parkeri. Sorry, this should be italics. Endemic in USA and South America. Japanese spotted fever by Rickettsia japonica and Queensland tick typhus. So this is the whole list. Now coming to rickettsial pox, also belonging to the spotted fever group, but this is important because it is caused by Rickettsia acari, and important thing is difference is that it is transmitted by mite. The rest of the above were transmitted by your ticks. Rickettsial pox is transmitted by mites, which show a trans-ovarian transmission. Reservoir here is the mice, mus musculus. Clinical features, it is almost the similar. Difference, it is, we call it rickettsial pox because the rash here are almost similar to your chicken pox rash, that is a vesicular rash. And there is an eschar at the site of mite bite with regional lymphadenopathy. So these are the this rash and eschar are there in scrub typhus also, eschar and lymphadenopathy. But the difference in the rash from scrub typhus is that this is a vesicular rash, whereas in that it is a maculopapular rash. Now coming on to very important, where this is the thing which on which you can get a short note in your MBBS, either on this or epidemic typhus or Rocky Mountain spotted fever. These are the three your MC questions, short note type questions which might come for your exams. And for the residents, this whole chapter is important because this can come as an LQ also. So scrub typhus or sugar-borne typhus, this was first described in 1930 in Japan. It was during the World War II that this disease killed thousands of soldiers who were stationed in the areas of the Pacific Theater. This disease is called Susugemuji. Susuga meaning dangerous and mushi means insect or bite. That is, it is a dangerous disease which is caused by an insect or mite bite. It is also known as bush typhus by we'll see later, which and this is caused by Oriensia susugemuji. So now we come to the epidemiology. It basically seen in the Susugemuji triangle. What is the this is the Susugemuji triangle. That is, this triangle is the area jahan pe predominantly seen. This Susugemuji triangle comes as your MCQs also. It extends from northern Japan and far eastern Russia in the north to the territories around the Solomon Sea into the northern Australia in the south and Pakistan and Afghanistan in the west. Okay, so this comes as an MCQ. It has more than 1 million cases every year worldwide, and over 1 billion people are at risk. It is important to know this thing that in India, Himalayan regions, your southern India, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, and West Bengal, they were thought to be originally endemic. These are the originally endemic areas. But I must tell you that Delhi also has lot of scrub typhus cases, and you must have known around 3 to 4 years back. It was AIIMS, New Delhi, and Dr. Rama only had reported a large number of in 2005. I don't remember the year. She was the one who had reported lots of cases of scrub typhus when they were originally thought that it was because of the chikungunya outbreak that this was happening. And it was later described that it was not the chikungunya, it was basically scrub typhus, that the outbreak was of sub-scrub typhus, and which was really causing a lot of mortalities. So this is the Susugemuji triangle. In March 2011, there was an outbreak of scrub typhus in the villages of Joginder in Himachal Pradesh, where more than 200 cases and more than 13 deaths were reported. In September 2011, outbreak of fever of unknown origin causing 3 deaths in Nagaland. So the agent in this is your Oriensia susugemuji. This has 5 major serotypes. I must tell my residents that Dr. Rama is very very fond of this, so you people must learn scrub typhus very hard. So there are five major serotypes: the Borion, Gimian, Carp, Kato, and Kawasaki. The vector is your larval mite or sugars of the genus Leptotropidium. Reservoir is rat. Host is naturally infects your other mammals like your rats, mice, and voles, and some birds as well. Man is basically an accidental host. When the man enters the enzoonotic area, it is then that man gets infected. So it is, and it is transmitted by sugar bite. So what is important here is and the habitat for these sugars is your scrub area or the dry habitats. Generally it is found in the scrub area. So what is this is another zoonotic tetrad is another thing which comes as your MCQs. That is, there are four elements which are really essential for its transmission, to maintain its transmission in the nature. One is the trombiculid mite. Second, the small animals, your mice, rats, and shrews, small mammals. Secondary, scrub vegetation or forest. Therefore, it is known as scrub typhus. And it since the mite lays egg in the wet season, the rainy season, the wet season is important. So this is your zoonotic tetrad, which comes as your MCQ: the trombiculid mite, the mammal, scrub vegetation, and the wet season. Okay. Now, when the mite feeds on the rodent and humans, the parasite is transmitted to the host, and the sugars or the mites can maintain it transovarially, that is from the adult female to the egg, as well as transstadially, that is from in the various stages of the egg, it is also maintained. And the more this also many a times has been seen as an MCQ, that only the larval the sugars are able to transmit the disease, not the full blown mite. Okay. So now coming on to the pathogenesis. The pathogenesis for all rickettsial pathogens is almost the same. That is, they will go inside, they will multiply in the vascular endothelial cells, the RE cells, causing vasculitis. Whenever there is vasculitis in the skin, it will produce skin rash, microvascular leaks, edema, tissue hyperperfusion, inflammation, vascular leakage leads to end organ damage in other areas like interstitial pneumonitis, non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, cerebral edema, meningoencephalitis, etc. And for your systemic systems, it causes procoagulant activity and DIC. So now important is the clinical features. It has an incubation period of 1 to 3 weeks. Same, the manifestation of all rickettsial pathogens is the same. That is your fever, rash, headache, myalgias. Here in scrub typhus, classically it has been described that there is SR and lymphadenopathy, but many a times we do not see those SR, and especially in the Delhi population, we have not been able to see the SRs. So fever is almost invariably present. By the third day of the illness, there is a sawtooth pattern, that is returning. Going to the, there is a spike, then returning back, then spike, then returning back. Then headache, which is a common symptom, which is more frontal or retroorbital area. SR, which is a non-pruritic lesion. This is a classical photo of an SR, 1 to 2 centimeter in diameter, black necrotic center, and erythematous periphery, which is present at the site of the bite. Occurs mostly on the extremities of the trunk or the trunk, but it may be found in the axilla genital area also. The rash which is there is maculopapular, pink to red, non-confluent. So we had, if you remember, rickettsial pox also had an SR, but the difference is you can see the difference between this rash. And you know how a chickenpox rash looks like. This scrub typhus will have a maculopapular rash and with an SR, whereas your rickettsial pox will have a vesicular rash with an SR. Your classical chickenpox ka jo rash hota hai with SR. because in that also we have lymphadenopathy, here also we have lymphadenopathy, and sometimes we may also have splenomegaly, and hepatomegaly is not characteristic of this disease. Complications stay the same for all the pathogens, because they can cause end organ damage leading to pneumonitis, meningoencephalitis, myocarditis, aseptic meningitis, renal failure, and DIC. Now, what is important is your lab diagnosis. In this also, there are a few things which are important. First is your non-specific tests. That is, there will be anemia, thrombocytopenia. There can be initially it can be normal, then low leukocytosis develops when the disease progresses. There will be hyponatremia, raised aminotransferases. CSF is generally normal, but at times there can be a mononuclear pleocytosis, and very few of the patients have elevated CSF proteins. Okay, these are your general, which are generally not helpful in differentiating any of the rickettsial illness. Now, what is important is your final this thing, specific methods, in which we have the isolation, the serology, and then the molecular. Isolation procedures, we have animal inoculation, egg inoculation, or the shell wild culture. The sample which we take here is either the blood sample. Blood sample may we will have to take the EDTA sample, or the tissue. Tissue may the rash or the eschar or the lymph node. This is what is taken, and this is inoculated into the either the animal or the cell lines, and it is seen when we if it is inoculated into the animals, we will see it by smear preparation by GIMSA staining. I'll come to, and all these inoculation isolation procedures are the most important thing is that they have to be done in biosafety level 3 laboratories. Now coming to I'll explain it in details. Like for your scrub typers, the Oriensia pathogen will grow inside the mice. So if a suspension of the blood clot or the tissue is inoculated intraperitoneally into the white mice, and then you will look into the mice for signs of infections, that is inactivity, ruffled fur, ascites. If the mice has a virulent strain, then it will die within 10 to 24 days. And then to confirm the diagnosis, you will make impression smears from the spleen surface, and you will stain it with GIMSA, which will have something like this. It has both intracellular and extracellular rickettsial organisms. So for Oriensia, you will be using mice. If you have to see for your rickettsial pathogens, you use the male guinea pig. This and in the male guinea pig, we classically see the Neal-Moser reaction. Another MCQ for your this thing. You do intraperitoneal inoculation into the guinea pig. You observe the animal daily and you record its temperature for approximately 3 to 4 weeks. Now, in Rickettsia typhi, conori and acari, that is your spotted fever group, there will be fever with tunica reaction or your Neal-Moser reaction. What is Neal-Moser reaction? That the scrotum becomes enlarged and the testes cannot be pushed back into the abdomen because of the inflammatory adhesion. This is classically known as the Neal-Moser reaction, which is seen in Rickettsia typhi, conori and acari. In Rickettsia rickettsii, it will cause fever, but there will be no scrotal necrosis. These are your spotted fever group pathogens. And when we come to the Rickettsia provazacchi, it will only and only cause fever without any testicular inflammation. But if you want to confirm the diagnosis, again, you have to just have to make the smears, and you will be able to demonstrate the Rickettsial pathogens by GIMSA or Jimenez methods. Okay, so in animal inoculation, for your scrub typhus group, we will use mice, and for the spotted fever and typhus group, you will be using your male guinea pigs. And this is how you are going to differentiate which species is it. But the disadvantage is that animal inoculation takes a long time, it is laborious, and you have to be really careful with the biosafety levels, and you have to do it in a biosafety level 3 laboratories which are rarely found in the nation. Then we come on to egg inoculation, which was somewhere classically done way back to basically to get the, this is basically for your research purpose, that scrub typhus is grown in the yolk sac of the embryonated eggs, and you will depending upon the infectious nature, it will cause death of the organism and it will produce the pathognomic lesions, and basically it is used to retrieve your antigens which have to be used for your serological test. But it is time consuming and it is a tedious procedure requiring proper isolation precautions. Another is way of demonstrating is your shell vial culture, that is your culture on your cell lines. Another way, basically cell line culture. In this, there is a cover slip on with the tissue culture monolayer in the shell vial. You will centrifuge it to enhance that it just deposits on the cover slip. You will incubate it for 35 degrees Celsius, take out the cover slip, stain it with a microscope, with a fluorescent light, and then observe it under a microscope, and you will see fluorescent areas. So this is one, this is a kind, basically this is a cell culture. So all these are your isolation techniques, but the important thing is that all these isolation techniques can be done only in a biosafety level 3 laboratory. What we normally do is your serological tests, because that is the simplest and that can be easily done for your population. But the classically what we used to do is your Weil-Felix reaction. What is Weil-Felix reaction? It is basically a tube agglutination test which does not directly involve your rickettsial antigens. Like we had studied earlier that the lipopolysaccharide shared of the rickettsia is also shared by the protease species, few of which like your protease OX strains are the antibodies which are formed against the polysaccharide of the O antigen of the X strain of protease species, also referred to as the protease OX strains. This was originally described by Weil and Felix in 1916. Because of the cross reactivity, which was mistakenly taken as a protease infection. So what we do is we will take the serial dilutions of the patient's serum, and we put our test protease strain, the protease vulgaris OX19, protease mirabilis OX2, and protease mirabilis OXK strain, also known as the Kingsbury strain. If the patient has epidemic typhus or endemic typhus, then OX19 is elevated. In the tick-borne spotted fever, OX2 and OX19 both are elevated. And in scrub typhus, OXK is elevated. So this is your classical Weil-Felix reaction, which was done sometime back. But the problem is it has a lot of false positives and you are false negative. False negative is because of the prozone phenomena, that is high antibody titers. This is the procedure which I just mentioned. You can do it on the slide method or by the tube method. And generally, a titer of more than 1:320 is considered as diagnostic. Or if you are doing serial dilutions, then you have to ask for 4-fold rise in the titer over at least a week of the patient sample comes today, and then you ask the patient to send a repeat sample after 1 week of the illness, and if there is a subsequent 4-fold rise or 4-fold fall in the titer, then you take it as diagnostic.
Ma'am?
Yes?
Can you explain prozone phenomena again, like how high antibody titer gives false negative?
Prozone phenomena mein the high antibody titers cross, there is a cross reaction, and the antibody, this was the general serology which you have must have studied, that to form a complex you need to have antigens as well as antibodies both in a optimal ratio, then only. If there is a high antigen also, you must have, do you remember the initial which we first, at first when the illness starts, there is a Sorry?
That's one graph was there that had
equal
concentration.
So in the initial, when the antibody titer is too high, it is not able to bind with the antigens too well to produce a complex which can be easily seen. To form a definite complex, which can be a visible complex, I should rightly say, to see a visible reaction, the antigen as well as the antibodies have to be in an optimal concentration. If the antigens are high or the antibodies are high, then it will not lead to a visible plaque or something. So if the antibodies are high, this is known as the prozone phenomena. Could you understand?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, got it.
So the false positive reactions are seen in patients with UTI due to Proteus, in typhoid fever, liver disease, leptospirosis, relapsing fever. So in all these, it is important that a single serum sample, if you are taking, then the titer has to be more than 1:320, or you do a see for a fourfold rise in the antibody titers. Complement fixation test, you must have read, but these are all obsolete. What we now do, Biel-Felix reaction is also of historical importance, but it is important because it comes in your MCQs. Complement fixation test, just to complete the list. IFA test is what is the gold standard these days, and here also in AIIMS we are doing IFA test, because it detects your antibodies in the serum as well as the other body fluids. You know that the IFA test may, we are going to, the antigen is prepared by smearing the dilute suspension of the rickettsial organism on the glass slide, and you are going to do a fourfold serial dilution of the serum sample, and you are going to see, and then you are going to add the anti-human antibodies fluorescent tag, and you are going to see it under a fluorescent microscope. IgM IFA is normally being done. Here we do the IgM IFA. A titer of more than 1:64 is considered as having an acute infection. IgM titer, basically it is important that it starts appearing in 5 to 10 days and peaks in 3 to 4 days. So the thing is that you have to see, again, the more important thing is that you have to see for a fourfold rise, or if the patient has been started on treatment, a fourfold fall in the antibody titer, which makes more significance. IgG titer of more than 1:254 is suggestive of acute infection, but here in normal condition, first thing, that scrub typhus is not being done in most of the places. IFA is very expensive, very time consuming, and requires lot of expertise. So normally we do IgM IFA, and that too it is done very rarely done. It's like, I think AIIMS is the only institute where we are doing IgM IFAs, even in, I don't know whether they are being done in PGI or not, but the problem is that they are extremely expensive and it is not widely available. Then one is, just to complete the list, though not done too often, is the indirect immunoperoxidase test, which is a modification of your IFA technique only, in which your fluorochrome is replaced by a peroxidase and the slide is observed under a bright field microscope. So here the only advantage is that you will not need a fluorescent microscope. You can do it under a normal microscope also. If the staining is brown color, means a positive staining, sorry. Immunocytochemical staining is done. It is just a modification of this immunoperoxidase staining, in which is done on tissues. Which is done on tissues directly, but it is time consuming. Then we have few rapid methods also available. Your dot plot assays and your BioLine Suzuki-Gamuzzi assay. These are your rapid methods which are used for IgM and IgG antibody detection. The principle is the same. Your ELISA based techniques hain. ELISAs are also available, but out of ELISA and IFA, IFA are more sensitive and specific, and your rapid ones are specific, but they are very less sensitivity. Then we have your molecular methods, like your PCR, which is done on blood, animal tissues, and sample from the vectors. Coming to your treatment, drug of choice is doxycycline, and chloramphenicol is reserved for patients in which doxycycline cannot be used, like you have allergies or pregnant women. Doxycycline 2.2 mg per kg per dose orally, and chloramphenicol 50 to 100 mg per kg per day 6 hours daily. And the therapy has to be continued for at least a week, and in many places it is said that the till the patient is afebrile, uske bhi 3 days extra you have to give the patient. Prevention is mite, termite control, you have to wear protective clothing, your local vegetation should be controlled, applying the repellents. All these are your normal preventive measures. Now, just to complete this thing, and this is mainly important for your MCQs, generally it is not going to come for your questions, and I'm running short of time, the next teacher has also come. So anaplasmatase has 4 obligatory intracellular organisms, your Ehrlichia, Wolbachia, anaplasma, and neorickettsia. They reside in the vertebrate reservoirs, and they target the vacuoles of the hematopoietic stem cells. Now you have to rectify this thing. Ehrlichia is predominantly in the mononuclear phagocytes. It causes human monocytic ehrlichiosis. This is Ehrlichia caffeinensis. Ehrlichia evigni, this is in the neutrophils, causing granulocytic ehrlichiosis. Anaplasma phagocytophyllum, it infects your neutrophils, causing human granulocytic anaplasmatosis. Neorickettsia senitsu causes infects your lymphocytes, and it causes mononucleosis like syndrome, that is your human lymphocytic ehrlichiosis. Each and every word here is important for your MCQs. Again, they acute febrile illness with headache, myalgia, arthralgia, cough. The presentation is almost going to be the similar. This is a small table. How will you differentiate? You can take the, if you have any doubts, you can take the slides from me. I will share it. I have no problem in sharing. The reservoirs, the mode of transmission, all these have to be rectified for your MCQs. And here also the drug of choice is doxycycline. Inclusions are seen and morula are seen. So these are your important MCQs which you have to say. So thank you so much. If you have any other MCQ, you can mail me. I think you people are.
अच्छा आप अटेंडेंस कराओ हाँ ये लो बैठो आप मैं आपको बताता हूँ कैसे करानी है मैडम ये रोल नंबर है ठीक है ना देख देख करके मैम 5 मिनट हैवी टाइम अभी आपका टाइम नहीं है आपका 5 मिनट बाद आपको 5 मिनट गिरेगी पहले
बंद हो गया कैमरा ऑफ कर दीजिए माइक
मैं आएंगे तो और लगा देंगे बस चलिए
कैमरा भी ऑफ कर दीजिए ये अटेंडेंस हमें लगानी होती है
हाँ
पिछली बार तो पहले तो
3610 से मैं बताऊँ
हाँ वो भी देंगे
3610 3520 3603 3508 3527 3557 3530 3574 3555 3544 3587 3535 3550 3566 3597 3570 3604 3614 3581 3572 3520 3595 3560 3565 3611 3517 3613 3445 last page, ma'am. 3445 last page. 3622 3560 बस मैम
3560 तो पहले लगा चुके
हैं। हाँ तो दोबारा भी लगा देते हैं। ठीक है। नो कैंसर।
बहुत सारे ऑप्शन हैं।
ठीक है आपका कौन है यहाँ आएंगे
नहीं नहीं इसको प्रोसेसर
करना अच्छा ठीक है ठीक है मैं इसको भी साइन करने आपने यहाँ आप मैम भी जरा आप भी जरा यो आपको सेंडर मैंने दे दिया था
गुड मॉर्निंग अंजना
क्या नाम है
गीतिका
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
आवाज आ रही है?
Yes, yes, बोलो. हाँ जी.
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
Okay. ठीक है.
ठीक है इसमें लिख दिया थैंक यू
We'll wait another 2 minutes.
Yes, ma'am. Only 11 students have joined. We'll wait. Ma'am, we can start the meeting.
Okay. So, good morning. Good morning, everybody. So, we are now actually in our first formal lecture on kidney. The last that we did was the urinalysis case study, and we talked about two very important features of kidney disease, which is hematuria and proteinuria. So we're going to backtrack now and go into more general considerations, things that we need to know about the kidney in terms of structure and function. And I will be introducing clinical syndromes. Okay. So we know about the kidney from very early studies in the 16th century, but now we know much more, of course. And we are going to be looking in this lecture in terms of gross anatomy, which is going to be a bit of an overlap with what you have learned in anatomy and histology also. And let's look at the functions. So in terms of gross anatomy, if you look at this slice of the kidney here, right? So it's been bisected and you're seeing the inner surface. You're seeing different structures here. So let's just go through the structures. On the absolute edge is this fine white line, which is the capsule of the kidney. It's a fibrous capsule. It's a true capsule, and it can be stripped off very easily from the external surface of the kidney in healthy kidneys. So when you have pathologies there, you'll see that the capsule gets very adherent to the kidney. Okay. Now, what is important to know about the capsule is that the capsule goes around like this, but it ends somewhere over here. At the hilum, right? So what is the hilum? First of all, the hilum is basically a vestibule which contains the various structures which enter and leave the kidney, which includes the vasculature as well as the collecting system, so the ureter which leaves, okay? So this hilum also includes the renal sinus. And what is the renal sinus? Basically, it's the fat. Just this yellowish, you can see that this is the adipose tissue, which is present in the renal sinus, which is actually like a little bit of cushioning for the structures which are entering and leaving the kidney. So why it's important to know that this inner area of the hilum, and here you've got the renal sinus fat, there is no capsule here, right? So this is very, very important when you start talking about malignancies in the kidney. The direction of spread or the tendency to spread can be very easy if a tumor is located here near the hilum because there's no capsule preventing further spread. Okay, so it's important to know that this area is unencapsulated. So the parts of the kidney on this cut surface also include this cortex, and you can see it here. It looks a little paler and brown, and then you've got the medulla, right? The cortex can be called here, you've got the peripheral cortex, then you've got the juxtamedullary cortex, which abuts the medulla. And in the medulla, you have the outer medulla, which are the rays. And then you've got these papillae. And if you were looking at them from this side, from the sinus side, you would see that it's a very cribriform sort of, you see a lot of holes there, which is called area cribrosa or Bellini's ducts. So ultimately, urine is going to drain in this direction from the medulla and into the collecting system, and you would have the calluses here of the collecting system. So calluses are divided into minor calluses, which are around 9 to 11, and then they become major calluses, which are usually 3. And then you would have the pelvis and the rest of the collecting system. So it's important to know the normal weight. So the weight of the kidney in males is approximately 150 grams, females 120 grams. So remember, 150 grams is a good number to remember for the kidney. And in terms of dimensions, around 12 into 7 into 3 centimeters. This becomes very important when you're looking at kidney disease, because when we talk about chronic kidney disease, the kidneys become very small and shrunken. So you need to know what is the normal dimension. So approximately 12 into 7 into 3 centimeters. Okay. Now, in terms of development, let's look at the next slide. Humans basically have a multi-papillary kidney. What does this mean? That you have these unipapillary kidney analogs, which tend to fuse together to give the structure of this kidney, right? And these unipapillary kidney analogs, each would have a little bit of cortex, some medulla, and it would have a calyx, okay? So when they're fusing together and all that calyceal system is also fusing together, we get the formation of two types of papillae. Papillae, I told you, are parts of the medulla, right? So you have two types of papillae. You have simple papillae and compound papillae. Now, these simple papillae are present in the mid-polar regions and they tend to have a convex tip because there's not a lot of fusion here. So you can imagine that you have these unipapillary kidney analogs here in the middle. There's not a lot of fusion here. Most of the fusion is happening at the poles. So when all this fusion is happening at the poles, you have the formation of more compound papillae. You can see here, they are much broader. They have flattened tips and they have these gaping orifices, which we talked about, which is the ducts of Bellini. Okay. So why is it important to know this? You should know that the kidney in terms of development is a fusion of unipapillary kidney analogs, as a result of which the poles, which have the compound papillae, are always going to be more prone to things like reflux, to things like ascending infections. Why? Because you have much more open papillae, which are the compound papillae. So it's much easier for bacteria to go up into the kidney. It's much easier for, if the patient has reflux, so sterile urine to go up into the poles. Okay. So you'll see that it's just not the normal gross. We need to keep in context as we turn towards pathology. What are the features in the gross anatomy which affect the pathology of the kidney? Okay. So that was the gross. But now if we look at this pictorial, we're really looking at the functional unit of the kidney, which is the nephron. And we know that the function of this nephron is to ultimately create urine, which is basically an ultrafiltrate of plasma. Each kidney has approximately 1 million nephrons. Okay, so we have, which is why, you know, even one kidney is actually enough for a human to get through life. One healthy kidney is enough. So we've got a lot of backup in terms of nephrons to maintain urine production and get rid of the excretory products that we need to get rid of. So if you look at the nephron, you will note that it's a very complicated structure. But it has different parts of it are in the cortex and different parts of it are in the medulla. Now, there are two types of nephrons. You've got the cortical nephrons, which are more higher up, more peripheral in the subcapsular zone, as you can see here. And then you have the juxtamedullary nephron. And there are some minor differences that we'll see. So each nephron is, of course, going to have a glomerulus. And then you've got the tubular mass, right? And the tubular mass starts as the proximal convoluted tubule. Then you have the Henle's loop. You will have the descending limb of the loop of Henle. You will have the loop here. And then you will have the ascending limb, which will get into the distal convoluted tubule, right? From there, the urine which is produced is going to go down to collecting ducts. And these collecting ducts or collecting tubules are going to come together and enter the medulla, where they're going to fuse much larger and then drain into the caliceal system. Okay? So let's look at the juxtamedullary nephrons. They're more deeply located, just abutting the medulla. Again, you're seeing the proximal convoluted tubule. And then you see that the loop of Henle is much longer. It goes much deeper down into the medulla. And then you'll have the ascending limb of loop of Henle. And then you'll have the distal convoluted tubule and the collecting system. So I'm going to leave this diagram on for a minute and then we shall ask some questions. Okay, so I hope everybody is awake this morning. Yes, Anjana, who should we ask?
Ma'am, Chirag.
Chirag, can you unmute?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So can you tell me, as you just look at this pictorial, we're not seeing any sections yet. If I take a section from the cortex, which part of the tubular system am I going to pick up?
The PCT and the DCT.
Yes. Okay. Where are the glomeruli present?
For the cortical nephrons, they are more towards the peripheral parts of the cortex and slightly deeper for the juxtamedullary nephrons.
Very good. So I will identify cortex on tissue as we look at slides. I will identify cortex on tissue when I see glomeruli. Sometimes you get a biopsy and there are no glomeruli. Happens. But I can still identify cortical tissue, because I will also be able to identify the types of tubules that are there. And so, like Chirag mentioned, the proximal and distal convoluted tubules will form the bulk of the tubular system in the cortex. Okay, thank you. Great, so let's move on. Now let's see some sections. So what you saw is a pictorial. Now we're going to see it on H&E stain slides. So what you're seeing here is the capsule. So like I told you, it's a fibrous capsule. It's a true capsule. And this is what collagen looks like on a hematoxylin here. So it's this pale, wavy, pink material. So there's the capsule. And then under the capsule, you've got the cortex. So this is the subcapsular cortex where you have the cortical nephrons, and you can just start seeing a hint of a glomerulus here, and you can see that it's a tubular mass. Now, as we go deeper, you will identify that there are some deeper located glomeruli. These are the juxtamedullary glomeruli, part of the juxtamedullary nephrons, and there you've got the medulla. Okay, so even on low power, you can really see the difference. And of course, if you've got glomeruli, you know that you are in the cortex. So now we're going to understand the histology of the cortex, and we always look at cortex in terms of four compartments. Okay, so it's the glomerular compartment, and you can see three glomeruli over here. You then have the tubular compartment, and we'll be looking at these tubules. Interstitial compartment, which is basically the connective tissue between the tubules. Okay. So it's a kind of a potential space. In a healthy kidney, you will not be able to make out interstitium. But the moment that there's some pathology, you will see that there is interstitial widening. So that's the third compartment. And the fourth compartment is, of course, the vasculature. So you can see a vessel here. So can we differentiate cortical tubules? You talked about proximal and distal convoluted tubules. Yes. On histology, they look very, very different. The proximal convoluted tubule, they are polygonal cells like you see here. So larger polygonal cells, they have abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm with low NC ratio. And because you've got this abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm, it feels like the nuclei are further apart. It has a brush border. This is the most important thing to remember, because this brush border provides functionality to the PCT, which is mainly reabsorption. And we'll look at that. And because you've got all this abundant cytoplasm, the lumen will appear smaller. In comparison, what does a distal convoluted tubule look like? You can see in this picture here, they are cuboidal cells, less cytoplasm. So it looks like there's a higher nuclear cytoplasmic ratio. Nuclei appear to be closer together. There is no brush border. And because you've got these smaller cuboidal cells, the lumen appears relatively larger or dilated. Okay. So let's go back. Yes. Anjana, can you choose somebody?
Megha Gupta.
Yes, ma'am.
Megha, can you see my arrow?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so I have put an arrow on a tubule. Do you think this is proximal convoluted or distal convoluted?
Proximal convoluted.
Very good. Why?
We can see the brush border appearance and the nuclei are not that dominant. And
not
yeah.
And abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm, right?
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
So now my arrow will point to this tubule here. What do you think this is?
This is DCT.
This is the DCT, right? So it's very
yes, ma'am.
Out that this is the proximal convoluted tubule and this is the distal convoluted tubule. Cuboidal cells, nuclei looking closer together, less cytoplasm. Okay. Okay. Thank you. So the brush border is very nicely appreciated on a special stain called periodic acid chips. This is a standard stain in kidney biopsy interpretation. And you can see here this eosinophilic brush border. Okay, I should have brought an EM image. I don't have an EM image with me now, but they look very nice, this microvillous brush border. Okay, and you can see in comparison, this is the DCT, which does not have the brush border. Okay, so now we come into the medulla. So the medulla gives an appearance of these parallel rays, which you had seen in the other image as well. And these are basically composed of the two types of tubules which are going to be in the medulla. You saw it going down from the nephron, both in the juxtamedullary and cortical. There were what parts of the nephron or the tubular mass? You would have the loop of Henle going down, and then it would go up again, form the DCT, and then come down again as the collecting tubules. The two types of tubules that you're going to identify in the medulla are loop of Henle and collecting tubules. So there is a pictorial here on the right upper side where there does appear to be a difference, but practically it's very difficult. So on cortex, we can easily differentiate PCT, DCT, but in the medulla, we do not need to also mostly. And it is very difficult to morphologically differentiate the loop of Henle and the collecting tubule. Okay. So let's move on. We've seen the glomeruli, we've seen the tubules both in the cortex and the medulla. Now let's look at the vasculature of the kidney. This has great implications in different pathologies, so we should know about it. So important to know that the kidney receives 25% of the cardiac output. Okay, so it receives a large cardiac output, which means that whenever we have any cardiac compromise or ischemia, that the kidney is very prone to develop acute tubular injury. Okay. And now let's look at the different parts of this vasculature. It starts with the renal artery, which forms segmental arteries. And then they form interlobar arteries, which are between the different lobes. And I'll point them out to you here. Can you see here? So between the different lobes, you have the interlobar arteries. And then they form arcuate arteries. So as the name suggests, arcuate means that they kind of arc between the cortex and the medulla. So interlobar, then you have arcuate. And from the arcuate artery, you will have these interlobular arteries. The interlobular arteries then branch to form the afferent arterioles, which enter the glomeruli, which form this capillary mass within the glomerulus, and then come out same from the same direction into the efferent arteriole. Okay. Now, the efferent arteriole then goes in the cortical nephrons. They are called peritubular capillaries. So they form these small capillaries, right? After arteriole, you need capillary. If we talk about the general way in which vessels branch and the different types that we have. So after the efferent arteriole, you have a capillary mass, which around the cortical tubular system, they are called peritubular capillaries. And when they go down in juxtamedullary nephrons, they go really deep down into the medulla where they're called the vasa recta. Okay, and you've learned in physiology, so this is very important in maintaining all our electrolyte balance. After this, of course, you've got the venous system. You have the interlobular veins, and it'll go in the same direction back. And then you have the renal vein. Okay. So it is a complicated vasculature, but we need this because if you think about it, this is where all that urine production is happening in this glomerular mass. So what are the things we need to remember? What should you not forget when you're thinking about the vasculature of the kidney? Number one, the arteries are functional end arteries. So if I go back, can you see this? This is the look of end arteries, right? So now if you go back to your general path knowledge, Anjana, can you let me see if I can pick up? Yes, can you call up?
Swapnil Kumar?
Yes, ma'am.
Swapnil, if you have functional end arteries in an organ and there is an infarct because of ischemia, what type of infarct would happen?
What kind of infarct?
What are the types of infarct?
Ma'am, I don't remember.
Okay, anybody else would like to volunteer? Anybody? Call out some names. Shubham. Shubham? No? Hardik Gupta?
Ma'am, it would probably be a wedge infarct. Wedge-shaped infarct at the periphery of the structure when there is an end artery.
What are the types of infarcts?
Red and white.
Red and white. Okay. So I'm asking you, would it be red or white?
White.
Okay. So that's the answer we're looking for. You have functional end arteries. So if you have an ischemic event, then you would get what we would call a white infarct. Okay. Of course, we call it something else in the kidney. We call it acute cortical necrosis, but we'll be going through that in the further lectures. Okay. Now, the other thing you must remember. So I showed you this complicated capillary network post-efferent arteriole, right? So you can see that all the tubular capillary beds are derived from efferent arterioles. Okay. So it's all connected to the glomerulus. So if the blood flow of a glomerulus is affected by a disease process, the tubules will also get affected and therefore the entire nephron is affected. What does this mean? This means that if you have glomerular disease, it is not going to spare the downstream tubules. So if a glomerulus becomes sclerosed or damaged and its vasculature is affected, then downstream vasculature is also affected, which is why you'll see that as kidney disease progresses, even if it's a glomerular hit first, ultimately the tubulointerstitial compartment will also get affected because they are so intimately connected. Okay. The third point to remember is that the blood supply of the medulla is derived again from the glomerular efferent arterioles, and the medulla is therefore always at a certain lower level of oxygenation and is also very sensitive to changes in blood oxygenation. Okay. So this is an example of an arcuate artery, which you saw would be coursing between the cortex and the medulla. Okay. So I'm back to that same image which I showed you in terms of four compartments, just to point out that this would be an interlobular artery and this is an arteriole. Okay. So when we identify the arteriole, we identify what we call the hilar pole of the glomerulus, because this is the pole at which the vasculature is entering. Both afferent is entering and efferent is leaving. That's the hilum. And the other pole would be the tubular pole, which is not always visible in every cut. But let me see, do I have an image? No, I don't. Okay. So if I see a tubular pole, I will show it to you. But generally, it will be somewhere opposite the hilum. Okay, this is what we consider to be the tubular pole. So these are the two poles of the glomeruli. Okay, then I wanted to just show you in higher power these images you've seen before. So we saw this image for what is PCT, what is DCT. And now just look between the tubules. You've got this little thin capillary. And this is called the peritubular capillary. I think somebody was mentioning it in the last case study about peritubular capillaries. So that's where they are. Okay. And this is the vasa recta in the medulla. So in this image, you can see it's very congested. So it's very easy to make out. So this is that capillary network which surrounds the juxtamedullary tubular system. Okay. So we talked about gross anatomy. We've looked at histology in detail. We've understood the compartments and we've understood how they are connected. Okay. But a very large part of what you're going to be learning in pathology is really going to be centered around the glomerulus. So we need to know everything about that glomerulus. And I do have a picture plate. So you can see here in this PAS stain section, a nice glomerulus with both poles nicely visible. This is the vascular pole or the hilum. Can you see? That's an arteriole. There, that's a large profile of this. And then you've got the glomerular capillary network. And you can see it's opening into the tubular pole, right? So it depends on the cut and the section. You will not always see this opening in. So what's happening here, of course, is you're having blood going through the capillaries, going through the filtration barrier, which we look at in detail, and what's coming out is the urine, which is the ultrafiltrate. Okay, The other structure you can identify here on the glomerulus is this capsule, which is the Bowman's capsule. Okay. Now, what is this filtration barrier, which is the whole crux of what this kidney is doing, which is filtration, boils down to this. The filtration barrier, if we just take out one loop, right? If I just took out one loop from here, and now I'm looking at it in this pictorial, what will I see? I will see that the filtration barrier has three layers, okay? The innermost layer is the endothelial layer. So you've got your endothelial cell, that's the endothelial nucleus, and it has these very long cytoplasmic projections, and these are fenestrated. Can you see the holes here? And these fenestra are approximately 70 to 100 nanometers in diameter, okay? That is the first step in the filtration barrier. So you now have some size-dependent filtering. Anything beyond 100 nanometers is not going through, okay? Now, the second step in the filtration barrier is the glomerular basement membrane itself. And this is a basement membrane which is rich in type 4 collagen. It's got some other glycoproteins and proteoglycans in there. And it has three layers, and we look at that on an EM image. But that's the second layer in the filtration barrier. And then we come to the third, which is on the outer surface. This is your visceral epithelial cell, which sends down foot processes. This is also colloquially called podocyte because foot-like. And this has slit pores between them, much smaller now, the gaps, which is approximately 20 to 30 nanometers. So can you see, just like a filtration process, you have a reduction in the lumen as you, a reduction in the fenestra as you go from the endothelial side to this visceral epithelial side. And this is going to provide you your size-dependent filtration, okay? Now, what is keeping all this glomerular capillary loops together in one place is the stalk, which is the mesangium. This has a mesangial matrix, and it has mesangial cells. They have a lot of functions, but just remember that this is the stalk which keeps the glomerular capillaries together, keeps it all together. Okay, so can you see all of this? If we take you to very high power, yes, I will show you all these cells that we have talked about. Okay, this is your capillary loop, like I showed you, right? So there is an endothelial cell, which is right there on the inner side. Then you've got the GBM. Then you will see the visceral epithelial cell or podocyte, which is on the outer side, and it's going to be leaving projections here. Okay. This is the mesangium. These are the mesangial matrix and cells, okay? Another important cell is the parietal epithelial cell, which is on the, just under the Bowman's capsule, along the Bowman's capsule. So just like you have visceral peritoneum and parietal peritoneum, or visceral pleura and parietal pleura, right? Same concept here. The cells which are just abutting the capillaries are called visceral, and that along the Bowman's capsule are the parietal, okay? So if we did a scan in EM, this is what a glomerulus looks like. You can see this leash of capillaries, and you can see that these are the podocytes, and you have these interdigitating foot processes. Okay, so it's actually very three-dimensional, and that's the body of the visceral epithelial cell, and look how it's sending projections. So they're called primary foot processes, secondary and tertiary, and they're interdigitating here. And now we look at transmission electron microscopy. What does it look like? So we would do EM for all our kidney biopsies. And we need to know what's normal here. You see a lot of pathology also on EM. But what's normal? This is the endothelial fenestra, like I showed you on the pictorial. This is the glomerular basement membrane. These are the foot processes. And between the foot processes, you would have the slit pores. I'll show that to you. So what are the layers of the GBM? You have lamina rara externa, which is this pale layer, then the densa, and then the externa. So if I zoomed in now, if I really zoomed in to what is happening between foot processes, you have these slit pores here, okay? And what you want to remember here is that these slit pores, the major protein component is nephrin along with podocin. Even if you remember that much, it's good, because when there is a mutation in nephrin, it results in nephrotic syndrome. Again, we'll talk about that later, okay? So your slit pore is mostly composed of these two proteins, nephrin and podocin, Okay. So now it should be very clear to you how this filtration process happens. It's a size dependent barrier function like I showed you. Is also a charge dependent barrier function because there are proteins in the on the podocyte surface which give it a negative charge. Okay. Overall, even the GBM has components which give it a negative charge. So this results in a size and charge dependent barrier function. Okay. Anjana, can we get somebody in?
Yes, ma'am. Pushwant?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so Pushwant, can you tell me what are the three parts of the filtration barrier?
Endothelium, basement membrane of the glomerulus, and the podocytes.
We're all away. Let's go on to the next. Thanks. So we talked about the major, absolute major function of the nephron, which is filtration and production of urine. Okay. But there are, of course, other functions of the kidney. It maintains blood pressure. It's very important for that. And in that, for that function, we have a particular specialized apparatus called JG apparatus or juxtaglomerular apparatus. Okay. So this JG apparatus has three components, which is shown in this pictorial over here. It is composed of specialized cells in the distal convoluted tubule, which is called the macula densa. Then you have a specialized sort of smooth muscle of afferent arteriole. And then you've got some extraglomerular mesangial cells of Lacus, we call them. Okay, so there's some supporting structure here between this DCT, which has the macula densa, and the afferent arteriole, okay? So can we see JG apparatus on histology? Yes, we can see JG apparatus, and you can see on this image over here. Can you see? This is DCT, definitely DCT. But even within the DCT, this part of the DCT looks very different. It's very condensed, you know, nuclei very close together, very cuboidal. This is the macula densa, okay? And then you've got an afferent arteriole over here. And this would have specialized smooth muscle cells of the afferent arteriole. These are called the JG cells. And their function is renin secretion. Okay. And then you've got the cells of Lacus. So how does it work? The renin is produced by the JG cells in response to either signals coming in from the chemoreceptor, which is the macula densa, which will check for sodium balance. So that's the chemoreceptor over here. And then the mechanoreceptor, which is actually the smooth muscle cells, which will respond to increase and decrease in blood pressure, right? So they would be mechanoreceptors. And then ultimately there is renin secretion. And this is how the kidneys are important in maintaining the blood pressure. So a lot of patients with chronic kidney disease and even in acute kidney disease, you will see alterations in the blood pressure. You get high blood pressure very commonly, okay? So that's the importance of the JG apparatus. Try to remember the three components. Other than that, the kidney is also involved in erythropoietin production. So kidney is involved in renin secretion. Kidney is also involved in erythropoietin production. We know erythropoietin is important for the RBC synthesis in the bone marrow to maintain that. And erythropoietin is secreted by interstitial fibroblasts. So we talked about interstitium. There are fibroblasts there which secrete the erythropoietin. That is why patients of chronic kidney disease tend to have anemia of chronic disease, right? We'll learn about all of this as well because the erythropoietin production is reduced. Okay, so we talked about filtration at the glomerular level and we talked about the cortex also being involved in renin secretion, erythropoietin production. What is the function of the tubules beyond that? Okay, so once the glomerulus produces 100% of that filtrate, the proximal convoluted tubule with its beautiful brush border, which I showed you what it looks like, that is responsible for reabsorption. So approximately 80% of the filtrate is reabsorbed in the proximal tubule, and it also kind of reabsorbs any proteins, the small proteins which have gone through the glomerular barrier jo bacha, it will try and reabsorb. So we really try and preserve the proteins, get them to go back into the body. Okay, so that's the PCT. The loop of Henle and distal tubule are very important. Actually, the rest of it are very important in water and salt conservation and maintain the sodium and potassium balance. Okay, so what's important to remember is the maximum reabsorption happens in the proximal convoluted tubules. So like I talked to you about the presence of glomerular and tubular proteinuria, the difference between glomerular and tubular proteinuria. So let us say the proximal tubules are damaged and there are certain conditions which can do that. So this function will not happen. And those little bit of small proteins which would have otherwise been reabsorbed are not going to get reabsorbed and they'll come out in the urine. So you do get some mild proteinurias of small size proteins, but it's not an albumin-rich proteinuria. We talked about that last time. Okay. So now just for completion about the rest of the kidney system, the epithelium we'll talk about. If you think about the epithelium, which lines from the pelvis downwards, it's called transitional epithelium. This is what it looks like. And you'll be seeing this in the bladder class as well. And this is a specialized epithelium which is adapted to distension, and it's also impermeable to withstand chemical environment of urine, which can be quite harsh. Okay, right. So I think the bulk of today's lecture is done. We've really gone into details of kidney. Are there any doubts at this stage? After that, we're going to really get into the clinical syndromes. No? Okay, we'll ask one question, wake everybody up, and then move on. Karthike, can you unmute?
Yes, ma'am.
Karthike, which part of the kidney is unencapsulated and why is it important to know?
Ma'am, hilum is the part of kidney that is not encapsulated because the blood vessels and ureter have to exit and come into the kidney from that part.
Very good. You know why it's important in terms of pathology?
I don't really sure. I'm not really sure about that.
Anybody else would like to jump in to answer the second part of the question?
Ma'am?
Yes.
If there is any tumor or something, then there are more chances that it will spread because there's no capsule to limit it.
Very good. Yes. So when you have cancers in that area, they very easily spread because you have an unencapsulated part. Okay. Thank you. Who is that? Megha?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, Megha. Okay. So we're going to move on to the second part, which is introduction to clinical syndrome. So we were talking a lot about normal. We were peppering it with a little bit of pathology, but now let's get into real full-fledged pathology. Let's understand the clinical syndrome. So you're going to hear about these repeatedly and you need to know, you know, what they are, what are the components, why things are happening, and what are the associated pathologies with them. Okay. So what does the term syndrome indicate? A syndrome indicates a constellation of signs or symptoms, right? Something's coming together, which we recognize that, look, all of this comes together and it means something. That's a syndrome in the absolute easiest way to explain it. Okay. So nephritic syndrome. What do we mean when we say that a patient is of nephritic syndrome? Nephritic syndrome patients tend to present with this combination of features. They tend to have hematuria. They tend to have azotemia and oliguria. Okay. So these clinical things, absolute details will be talked about by our clinicians, but I will give you a brief idea of what we mean. So azotemia means a biochemical abnormality which will come in as a raised creatinine or uric acid level, right, in the blood. So that biochemical abnormality is called azotemia. When patients become symptomatic with other features, we call it uremia. Oliguria means a reduced urinary output. Okay. So what do these two things together mean? Azotemia, the biochemical abnormality and reduced urine output indicates a reduction in GFR, which is the glomerular filtration rate. Okay. So our glomeruli are not working well. There is also hematuria. There is also variable proteinuria, which is associated with variable edema. Okay, so proteinuria and edema, I put it together because when there is protein loss, and then because of the hydrostatic and osmotic issues, you're going to have third space fluid movement, which is what results in edema. Okay, and then you see the next point, which is hypertension. So we know why kidney disease produces hypertension. We've understood that it's a major function of the kidney to maintain our blood pressures. Okay. So when all of these things come together, when this patient has, you'll get history of reduced urinary output, there will be hematuria, which could be even gross hematuria, and there'll be some edema and puffiness and hypertension. When it comes together, we think that the patient has nephritic syndrome. And the classical example is a post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis. Okay. Now if you look at this image on the right, and we'll talk about the pathology later, but if you look at this image on the right, you'll understand why these glomeruli are not working. It's very clear, right? How can you have any glomerular filtration when glomeruli are filled with cells, which is what happens in a post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis. Okay. So you've got all these cells there, which are now damaging the glomeruli. Damage of glomerulus will cause release of red blood cells, produce hematuria. Damage in the glomerulus will affect filtration barrier, which is going to be damaged, and so result in proteinuria and edema. And of course, you'll have hypertension. And glomeruli, which are full of cells, are not going to be able to filter anything. Urine production is going to definitely reduce. You're going to get oliguria and azotemia. Okay. So what I'm trying to say is nephritic syndrome usually is going to be associated with a proliferative glomerulonephritis. Okay, so when you have a very proliferative glomerulonephritis, you're going to get all these features of nephritic syndrome. So if I saw the urine of a patient of proliferative glomerulonephritis, can somebody tell me what kind of sediment would I see? We talked about it last time. Anybody? So I'll answer that. We'd see an active sediment, which I talked about last time. Active sediment, you'd see a lot of dysmorphic red blood cells, RBC casts, WBCs would also fall through. You can see a lot of WBCs in this glomerulus. Okay. And that would be the kind of sediment also. So you would get a good correlation of what this patient has. You would label the patient nephritic syndrome based on these features. You check the urine, see active sediments, and advise a biopsy. Now, in case the clinical features are very rapidly progressing with a rapid decline in GFR within hours to days, then along with all of these features, you will see a faster decline, oliguria and urea, then we would call it RPGN or rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis. So that's the second syndrome. And the RPGN again would correlate with usually a proliferative glomerulonephritis, which is more severe. So RPGN means a more severe glomerular disease. Now on the other side of it, you have nephrotic syndrome. Okay. So what is nephrotic syndrome? Nephrotic syndrome is characterized mainly by a very heavy proteinuria, and that is defined as more than 3.5 grams in 24 hours. And with this heavy proteinuria, if you check for serum albumins, of course, you will have hypoalbuminemia. And with this loss of albumin from the capillaries or the circulation, you will develop third space loss of fluid, which will result in edema. So these three things come together. You also have hyperlipidemia. So patients generally have very high cholesterol levels, and you will also see lipiduria. Okay. So why does this happen? Hyperlipidemia, lipiduria. The hypothesis is that In the presence of such low albumin, the liver tries to compensate by producing protein, but in the process, it also produces excess lipid. And there is hyperlipidemia, lipiduria due to that. And there's also other hypothesis of transport issues in lipid. But we see all of this together. So this constellation is called nephrotic syndrome. Okay, so very different from what we saw in nephritic syndrome. So the classic example of this pathology is a minimal change disease or a focal segmental glomerulosclerosis. And that is what an FSGS looks like. Okay. But what I want you to remember is basically it indicates that there is a direct hit to the filtration barrier. And the usual culprit is the podocyte. Okay. So when you have something which is affecting the filtration barrier, especially podocytic diseases, primary or secondary injury to the podocyte, is when you get very heavy albumin-rich proteinuria. And this is what we call nephrotic syndrome. Okay? So these patients are also very prone to hypercoagulable states, as well as they're very prone to infections. So can somebody answer why? Why would you think these patients with heavy protein loss tend to have coagulation disturbances? They may present with renal vein thrombosis, thrombotic tendencies, and also more prone to infections.
And maybe liver produces more clotting factors, or maybe okay. Derangement clotting process.
Yeah, you're probably right. Wow. That also the loss of anticoagulant factors in the urine. You know, when you have such damage to the filtration barrier, you're losing a lot of good stuff from the blood, including anticoagulant factors and also including, you know, like complement components and things like that, which help us fight infections. Okay. So children, especially with nephrotic syndrome, they are prone to developing infections also. And you also get clotting episodes, especially in heavy proteinuria. So some patients will have 10 grams of protein coming out, 15 grams of protein coming out in 24 hours. So these patients, you have to always keep a check for these two things. Okay. Now, so these are like full-fledged syndromes, but prior to that, or sometimes patients who have mild glomerular abnormalities may not present with full-fledged syndromic features. They may have asymptomatic proteinuria, hematuria, and you would actually pick it up on a routine. You know, there's a routine medical exam happening for something and you pick up significant number of red blood cells or significant proteinuria. And this patients, when they get biopsied, they tend to show mild glomerular abnormalities. Now we have two syndromes left. One is called acute kidney injury. That is the preferred term now, which is preferred to acute renal failure. But what we mean is the same thing. Okay. It indicates a rapid decline in GFR within hours to days. And you will see this decline in GFR. It will present as an oliguria or an anuria. And biochemically, you will get azotemia. Okay. Now, we understood from our previous discussion on nephritic syndrome that some glomerular diseases can get very severe, right? Which we call RPGN. So one cause of an acute kidney injury or an acute renal failure could be glomerular. When there is severe glomerular injury, like in an RPGN, okay? But remember that the other compartments can also result in this sort of failure of the kidney, including the tubulointerstitial and vascular compartments. So this will again be talked to you, will be discussed in detail. But you just imagine, let's say I have a thrombus lying in the hilar arteriole, okay? Thrombosis ho gaya, which we call thrombotic microangiopathy. So no blood can enter the glomerulus. So it's not a primary glomerular disease, it's a primary vascular disease. But of course, nothing is going to come out. Your GFR will be minimal. Your patient will have anuria or oliguria, depending on the type of injury, okay? So that's just to give you an idea of every compartment of the kidney has different types of pathologies which can result in the syndrome of acute kidney injury or acute renal failure. Okay. On the other hand, you could have chronic kidney disease, which is the preferred term now. The old term was chronic renal failure. And what this means is a persistently diminished GFR for at least 3 6 months. Okay, there are a lot of clinical definitions out there in your seminars. All of this will be talked about from the clinical side, which is the correct definition. But what we basically understand as CKD is there will be a diminishing GFR for at least 3 months. Okay, and this is usually a more insidious process. Patients will be unaware and they will suddenly come with uremic features and you'll find a deranged creatinine. Okay. And this, of course, happens due to chronic renal parenchymal damage. And again, we understand that the damage could be in any compartment. It could be chronic glomerular disease, chronic tubular interstitial disease, or chronic vascular disease like a hypertension, long-standing essential hypertension. Okay, all of these things can result in chronic parenchymal damage. Now, the later stages of CKD, where GFR is less than 5% of normal, is called ESRD. Or ESKD, end stage renal disease. Okay, so that's like the absolute end. At this point, patients will become now dialysis dependent. They will get worked up for renal transplant if it's indicated. Okay. So that's it for this class. The next class is going to be glomerular pathology and nephritic syndrome. So you now know what nephritic syndrome is. You can predict the types of glomerular diseases which will be discussed. Dr. Adarsh will take this class and will talk to you about the different diseases and how we proceed with diagnosing them, what are the features on pathology. Okay. Right. Any doubts? Any questions? So I think this is a good time for you to get into your texts and go through these initial part, which really talks about, you know, not just the histology, the overview from your pathology text. This is a good time to get into it. Okay. And we will expect you now to be able to identify glomerular structures, all the parts of the cortex as we start showing you slides. And what I have not spoken about is our approach to kidney biopsy in terms of what special stains and all we use. But I think maybe we can touch upon that as we show you the pathologies. Okay, so I showed you one stain today. Can anybody tell me which special stain did I show you? Last question for today's class. Which special stain did I show you? Hemant. No? Any PGs in here? No.
PAS stain.
PAS stain. Yes, thank you, Hardik. You know the full form of PAS?
Pyriodic acid shift.
Pyriodic acid. Okay, great. Okay, next, Anjana, is Wednesday?
Ma'am?
Wednesday is our next...
yes, ma'am. Next Wednesday.
Next Wednesday. Okay. Okay, thank you. Aap attendance, aap dekh lena, Anjana.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.